Hello, my name is Jonathan Humphreys. I am the head of the International Hotel Development, Asset Management and Finance Specializations at the Lyon Institute of Higher Education. Welcome to Leading Hospitality Through Turbulent Times. This session is on what makes great leadership and successful organizations of the future. This session will be a discussion of approximately 45 minutes, including Q&A. We're taking questions in the chat only, and you can submit these as we go along. And just a reminder that the session is being recorded and will be available on the Moodle platform afterwards. Now I'd like to introduce you to our very special guest today. Simona Gibbottoni is the CEO of Clinique La Prairie, one of the most iconic and exclusive health and wellness brands in the world. Simona is not only a CEO of this pioneering business, he is a thought leader and author of the High Performance Company Manifesto and The Path to Professional Excellence. He has also been a GM and CEO of several international companies focusing on luxury and business performance enhancement, and has a deep knowledge of Asia, where he created several businesses in the cosmetic field. It is an absolute pleasure to introduce you all now to Simona Gibbottoni.
Thank you, Jonathan. Nice to be with you today. Thank you very much. Okay, listen, it's always a pleasure for me to be with you guys, with all the activity that you do in Lyon. And I would like to start with a quick introduction about the model that I plan to present to you today, how I came to this model that I would like to share with you today. I've spent 10 years in consulting, and after 10 years I took a role in a company, in a line role in a company, and I discovered that a lot of the things that I was teaching as a consultant were quite irrelevant for the success of the business. So I decided to write down all the things that I thought was really working in what I was doing. And that's how I came to my small book, High Performance Company Manifesto. And that's the idea of the summary that I would like to present to you today. Basically, this, I call it High Performance Company Blueprint, is based on a foundation, which are the leadership skill. We will not have time today to go through this, but this, of course, is the foundation of every company. Some ideas on culture and people side, which is the left side of this chart, and some ideas in terms of system and processes. Then on top of this, so important, we will not discuss about this, but there are the management tool, what we do every day in our company. We will not have time to go through everything, so we will focus on a few ideas today. And my belief is really that the companies that are able to implement these guidelines, this idea, are the company which are really able to survive, I would say really not only strive in good times, but also to survive even in the worst of the crisis. So if you agree, I would start from the first, the left of this blueprint, which is talking about culture and people. As we say, culture is eating strategy at breakfast, no? Which means really that the culture in a company is the most important thing. And if you look at companies that has been able to really excel, excellent leader in companies that has always at the end been able to change the culture of this company. Culture is about the attitude of the people, their belief, the expectation, what people thinks a company can do, what people think is possible to do or is not possible to do. I think here is there are three mindsets important in a company in terms of culture of people. The first one is take responsibility. This means that the belief that we can influence, even in the worst of the time, the result of our company. We put here some example of the last 50 years. You can see on the right side how many crises we had in the last 50 years, and how many companies have been able to grow and flourish during crisis time. So as I put in the title, there are always winners and losers in bad and good times. So yeah, taking responsibility meaning means know that we can succeed even in the worst time, and worst time can be an opportunity. Then we are talking, here is the example is, let me make an example on Clinique La Prairie. We decided to go back to our motto that we started in 2016, which was, what if your health was your true wealth? Then we changed it to unlock the secret of living. Now we are going to go back to this motto, which we think is so true today for our guest. And despite this terrible period for hospitality, we think that there is a huge potential for us at the end of the tunnel. And here we really feel that there is a tremendous opportunities for us, and that's the mindset that we try to apply for really helping more and more people spread even more our message, helping even more people living a longer, healthier, and better life. So you see this terrible situation, I think, is really putting us in a positive mindset at the end for the future. Talking about mindset, this ability to be focused on result, financial results are so important today. You know, companies is a question of survival today, but also people result. I think that these last 2 months has been also tremendous opportunities for the companies to focus on rethink our business, invest in our people, think about new ideas. And at the end, we had time to educate ourselves again. And that's why I'm making this distinction between two types of results that we always need to keep in focus, financial result and people result. I wrote it educate or die, no? Or we are able to have to take out the best from our people, or of course our company are gonna die. The second part of this culture and people side of the blueprint is talking about some other ideas. Create the best possible management team. That's super important, of course, having the right people with you to grow the company. Build a culture of help. We'll discuss it later when we talk about coaching. I strongly believe a company is to have always this ability to generate new ideas, a lot of new ideas, but then be very focused on few things. Manage agreement, not people. I don't think that we can manage people. We can inspire people, we can motivate people, we can manage agreement, but we don't manage people. Get your hands dirty means that people in companies need really to be in the business. We will see it later. And then coach for success. I know, Jonathan, that you told me that you are making a session on coaching, right? In one of the next...
Yes, that's right, Simona. We have a session coming up on coaching in a couple of weeks and the importance of coaching. And I think at least my understanding of, let's call it holistic leadership, it kind of needs to take into account several aspects. One is, obviously, you need to have experiences of both good times and bad times, and you need to have been able to weather those storms. You obviously need education and knowledge, expert knowledge. And I think also it's really important to have both mentoring and coaching. And there is a difference between the two. Mentoring is more informal and coaching is more formal and specific. And Simona, I was wondering if, you know, I'm a great believer that you kind of need all of those things to work together in order to develop your career, in order to develop, you know, oneself. And I was wondering if you're able to give an example of, you know, how coaching has helped you during your career to achieve your different goals.
Yeah, Jonathan, I think that I love this approach of coaching. Here I put this GROW model. I really invite all the listener, all the student to deep dive on this model of coaching. Here, basically, we are saying we are not imposing to people objective goals, but we let people analyze the reality. We let people define their goal. We let people think about options on how to reach the goal, and together we build a plan, a commitment to reach this goal. I think it's a fantastic model. Like you said, it's not the only model that can be used, but it's a fantastic model to empower people in a company. And I personally use a coach. I've used a coach in the last 3 months to help me reset my goals, professional and personal goals. So I think that's really a tool which is very, very powerful, both on a personal level and the professional level.
Thank you, Simona. And I'm just wondering, I mean, we're going to touch on this a little bit later with regards to the importance of knowledge and education. But there is, I think there's a great example with regards to Bill Gates and his transformation from the world of technology into the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, where he basically combined a lot of these aspects regarding education and knowledge, and then also coaching from some of the best experts on his transition into this new arena. Maybe you'd like to touch on one of the solutions that he was able to create as a consequence of kind of embracing these different aspects of leadership.
Absolutely. Listen, I think now there are some critics now recently on Bill Gates, but I think there are two things which for me are super interesting about him. The first one is this idea that this always search for continuous learning. No, Bill Gates is known for taking this retreat week where he's taking like 100 books with him. He's a speed reader and is gonna get immersed into this book for 1 week. And then when he was coming back to Microsoft and now to the foundation, he's coming with a lot of ideas. And that's the first thing. So this idea of the importance of continuous learning. And then the second point is lateral thinking. And you were mentioning this, what he did with this toilet in the poorest part of our world. And this the solution that he proposes really coming out from this process of thinking in a completely different way compared to the usual thinking, which I think we will see it later, especially when you think about strategy, when you think about strategic planning, is really a fundamental skill to build a different kind of future and to build a different kind of business model in your company or in your life, in a sense. So I think it's a wonderful example, yes.
Yeah, and I guess just for those that aren't aware, he approached the problem differently because he realized a lot of the challenges were around implementing the infrastructure within the different environments around the world where health and sanitation was a massive problem. And he said it's all around the maintenance of the piping, the sewer systems, the water systems. So he created this toilet that didn't need any of that, didn't need any of the piping, didn't need any of the water, and was just essentially a self-cleaning standalone item, which is, you know, obviously revolutionary. Okay, thank you, Simona.
Right. Listen, if now we move on the right side of the chart, we talk about more system and processes. It's sometimes difficult to make a distinction between culture, system, and processes. But here, I would like just to give you some ideas. First of all, deep dive your market means making this effort of understanding everything about the market in which you are in. You cannot believe, Jonathan, I'm sure that you know, but unfortunately how many CEOs know so little about their competitor, the products, the trends of the market they are in. And only if you deep dive your market, only if you know everything about your market, then you can think about a unique strategy and unique business model for your company. Why I'm writing here dream of the impossible when we are talking about strategy and business model? Because the strategic planning is a process which is not only rational. There is a lot of dreaming it, there is a lot of gut in it, there is a lot of this ability to think about something which is not existing yet. And then finally, this importance of creating a strong reason why in the company where we are, or even for ourselves. Like company mission, personal mission, I think is so important. We have here, for example, in Clinique La Prairie, we defined 4 years ago a strong reason why, a strong mission, which is helping people living a longer, healthier, and better life. And you know, for me, it's so inspiring to have every day this mission, which is guiding me and guiding my people. And I think it's really fantastic. It's really fantastic for me when a client is leaving and say, "Ah, Mr. Gibertoni, you know, really after 1 week in your place, I really have been able to change completely my life." Now, that's the biggest inspiration for all of us. A few more comments here, talking about strategy and market, the importance of innovation, the importance of making innovation really part of the culture of the company. The fact that small company can really compete in innovation with big companies. Sometimes companies are too big to innovate, so it's amazing for me to see how still company like us, which are not so big, we can really come out with fantastic innovation. Now our competitor, big company, now everybody, you know, Apple, Google, they are all into our health and wellness market more than the traditional, let's say, hospital and traditional company. And remembering, and that's also a message for all the people listening, that innovation is not reinventing something incredible. Innovation is even a small improvement of something which is existing. And I think we need so much of improvement of what is existing. There is a huge market even there. So we don't have to think, we don't have to fall into the trap that only if we have a magic idea, we can make the difference, no? Because that's innovation, again, it's always making small innovation to what is existing. And finally, dream big, but then remember that bad execution kill even the best strategy. So at the end, is execution is the key. I put here the example of Richard Branson, if you want, a little bit stereotype, but I think is interesting for what you were saying before, Jonathan, this idea of learning, know the business, challenge the status quo, and having this idea of lateral thinking. That's a wonderful example of this. There is another example of lateral thinking that I wanted to, and let's say, this idea of implementing different strategies I wanted to share with you. Everybody is asking us as Clinique La Prairie to go, we are into a very selective market, we are able to serve only a few people, so everybody wants us to go into a bigger market. No? Why don't you make a bigger place with more room, with the ability to serve more people? And we decided that 2 years ago, I presented this in Lyon 6 months before we start to open this, the opposite idea. We said, no, we want to do the opposite. Instead of serving more clients, we want to serve one client and offering to one client all the services that the client can find today at Clinique La Prairie. So we created the CLP Retreat, which is this offering of coach, chef, doctors, therapist only for one client in beautiful location. And I think this also is, if you want, this idea of try to do things different compared to the market. Another example that I wanted to make is because I see it so much today in the business. Let's try to be always focused on what we are good at doing and not falling into the trap of try to do everything for everybody. And finally, I wanted to leave you with this, talking about strategy, with this idea and this beautiful book that I invite you to read, which is this idea of thinking about building a company which has not an end. So the importance, much focusing on us, on the long term instead of the short term. I know that you also love this book, Jonathan, you told me, right? And Simon Sinek.
I think it's what's interesting about this is it shifts perspectives on what's possible. For those of you that haven't heard of it or haven't read it yet, the essence of it is that there are two games that companies and individuals play. It's one is called the Infinite Game, and one is called the Finite Game. And as an example, he uses the difference between Microsoft and Apple. And Simon Sinek went to a presentation of executives regarding the future of education. At the Microsoft presentation, 70% of the executives were talking about how they could beat Apple. And when he went to the Apple presentation, 100% of the executives were focused on how they could improve education. And so, you know, the difference here is, you know, for the finite players, they tend to talk about how they essentially can just beat the competition. The infinite players are focused on how they can improve and continuously beat themselves. And right. I think when you can apply that analogy to companies, you could apply it to governments, you can apply it to individuals, you can apply it to teams. So I think it's in terms of changing the game and the perspective of the game, both towards personal development and also towards businesses, I think it's a very I think it's a very fascinating perspective.
True, very true.
Thank you, Simona.
And last point that I wanted to make with you is now be the best is the only market that's not crowded. Very true. And the point here is that there is so much mediocrity today, you know. So few people that are really searching for excellence. So there are infinite possibility for the people that really wants to bring us a product, a service which is excellent on the market. There is a quote that I want to make to you of Robin Sharma, which is say, leave the cult of mediocrity to get into the club of mastery, which I love it. And today with the, you know, our phone, we see really how, unfortunately, we are all ending into experience, which are for sure very far from excellence. Now, last slide of the blueprint is, again, on system and processes. The importance of defining KPI, here again, we are more into the art part of the company. But of course, you cannot improve what you cannot measure. Setting up KNI routine. KNI means constant and never-ending improvement routine. Again, here we're talking about innovation. We're talking about putting together systems which are able to make innovation not something which occasionally happens in the company, but something which is really on the day-to-day of our business. Deep dive your customer, like for the market, you need to know everything about your clients. Let me come back 1 second to the market. If you have also a student, the idea of the market where you want to work, where you want to get in, try already to understand everything about this market. I go to the last point, make NPS your guiding principle. You are all of you the master of the Net Promoter Score in the hospitality. For me, for us in Clinic La Paris, becoming really a fundamental part of our organization is really, I call it the guiding principle because here we have a 92% Net Promoter Score. For us, it's really what is guiding the action of all the people in the company. And then create an high performance marketing. What is an high performance marketing for me? Here is the point is that marketing is creating and market a product which is really able to change the life of the people. Better if you are able, from my point of view, better if you are able to change few people, but to really change their life than to change many people, again, with mediocrity. The fact that you need to really to seek to make real change. And again, it's better to have a smaller market where you are able to really create a lot of value then vice versa. I was telling you again before, what is the greatest satisfaction to me is when we are able to really change the life of our client, you know? And we have the example, I put the example of the drill, I think it's a very nice marketing example when we talk about really understanding the real change that you want to make and how you can really change the life of your customer and what your customer really want. What is the example of the drill? That people are not buying the drill, no? People are buying the feeling of calmness and serenity that they will have when the new bookshelf that they will, that they are going to build thanks to the drill is going to be in their house. So in reality, they are buying this feeling. They are not buying the drill. So they are buying the emotion, which is related to the future bookshelf. Right, Jonathan, I know that you also like this example. And last time we spoke, you told me about the bookshelf and the drill and making the bookshelf, which I think is a wonderful example, even better than making the hall.
Yeah, exactly. And I think you can take it even further, obviously, with the knowledge that you obtain as a consequence of that bookshelf, right? So it's kind of, you can kind of take it even further away from the drill if you want to, right? So I think it's a great example.
Yeah. So the message is people are not, that's fantastic. People are not buying the drill. Wow, they are buying the knowledge. They are buying the knowledge of reading book, you know. That I think is a fantastic step in terms of marketing. And then finally, always remember that in terms of organizational design, we need to be sure that always the organization is built to put at the center of our attention what the clients pays for. And know what the clients want today. Today, the needs of the clients are changing very fast. And the organization, you know, the more, especially the more they grow, the more they tend to put the interest of the people working in the organization at the center of the attention and not the client. So that's, of course, absolutely important. So, Jonathan, if you want, we can go to the to how, in a sense, quickly the COVID situation has influenced this principle. In reality, not influenced, but has, let's say, increased the need of being even more transformational on some principle.
Yeah, I think that would be really helpful, Samana, because a lot of there's been a lot of talk, obviously during the current crisis, and we're seeing various waves of it, as you know. We obviously saw the pandemic, the very unfortunate situation. We're seeing the economic fallout of that, potential societal fallout of that. There's been a lot of talk around pivoting and repositioning. And I think it would be really helpful. You've obviously spent a lot of time during this situation to really try and understand how you want to take the business forward. It would be, I think, really helpful for the audience to, for them to understand the process that you went through, some of the thinking that you went through, and also some of the plans, if you're able to share those with the audience, of how you are planning to take things forward a little bit differently from before.
Yes. Well, let's say first 8 points, which are related to leadership and management. I think there are here a few points that we have been obliged, let's say, to activate in the last month. I put here, forget job description. Everybody now has to do everything. We are in emergency mode. We need to take decision very fast. We have to stay positive, we have to stay calm, but at the same time, fear is a fantastic way to move the company where we want the company to go. We don't have to think about being perfect, but we need really to make a lot of communication in these days in our companies. We need to be ourselves a role model. And all of this at the end is useful because we are obliged to apply zero-based thinking, which is a strategy that I love. Everybody's talking about the zero-based budgeting, but you can push it forward with the zero-based thinking, which is answering basically to this question. If we were building the company today from scratch, what we would do differently? So now we are obliged to think that after the COVID, the market can be completely different from the past. the needs of our client can be completely different. So we have to take this opportunity to rethink completely our company. And what is difficult is that you have to work at the same time, at the short term, what's going to happen today and tomorrow, and in the long term to rethink about the business model of the company. And finally, very important, this is the time where we will probably need to take very difficult decision, and we have to continue to be, to put the people at the center, be compassionate and be human, even if we have to take difficult decisions. This is in general for leadership and management. There are some effects, of course, in terms of hospitality, in terms of what we do as a Clinique La Prairie. There is an article that maybe Jonathan, you can share about how I wrote an article about few, let's say, trends in hospitality 3 years ago, and now the COVID has affected these trends. Let me focus just on two of these trends. First, in our business, connection and humanity is fundamental. And now we are reopening, all of us, with this separation, 1 or 2 meters separation, the mask, plastic, glass everywhere. So yeah, there is a big, big challenge on how to keep this connection and humanity, even in the next few months where we will still need to have all these measures for the COVID. In our case, we are really making less connection, but much more meaningful. We have created what we call client angel, which are people that really single people that needs to take care of all the needs of the client, wherever they are in Clinique La Prairie and whatever they need. And then there is this point of proximity and the need of enrichment and experience. So we have to, of course, it's not new what I'm saying, people will not move for the next 12 months unless they are gonna feel that they can have a unique experience, a different experience, something which is really creating value in their life. No? So that's again for all of us, a reason to rethink our business model and rethink how we can really create value for our clients, for our guests, because otherwise they will stay, they will not move, they will not take a plane for 15 hours to have an experience that they can have at 50 kilometers from where they live. So that's another big challenge that is confronting all of us in the next months.
Thank you, Simona. I don't know if you'd like to take a question here. It refers back to the infinite game. It's from one of our esteemed colleagues at Gleon. She's head of the luxury specialization, Barbara Chiseska. I'll kind of wrap this question around a little bit just to kind of give it some context. For the audience, a lot of companies are still focused on quarterly earnings. There's a lot of pressures by shareholders, investors on, you know, quarterly results, a lot of the, you know, organization restructurings. And we've seen that it dramatically in this particular crisis, you know, and it's had huge impact because of this quarterly focus. And so Barbara's, you know, said that, you know, despite the fact that so many leaders and thinkers advocate for applying this kind of strategy, so many companies are still focusing on short-term goals. How can young people implement these excellent ideas while being employed by companies which do not necessarily think the same way? I think it's a challenging question. Yes. But it is, it's relevant to the world of work today in terms of the disconnection, in terms of the games that are being played, and also the way that we think of as human beings, which generally we think about the infinite game. I mean, at least, you know, in terms of our continuous development and involvement in humanity. So how do you kind of, I mean, it's a big question, but how would you like to approach this one?
Barbara, it's a wonderful question. First of all, I mean, I think that we are all so much inspired by this concept, because in fact we see that they are not applied so much. So that's to confirm what Barbara was saying. Unfortunately, we see in let's call it in the real world happening probably the opposite of this. I would, Jonathan, I would go back to my first point, which is take responsibility. I think that each of us can really influence. It's not important if you are able to influence one person in our organization, 100 person, 1,000 or 10,000 person, but we all of us has the capacity to influence. And like I was saying, in terms of marketing, no, focusing really on influence for the better. And it's not important, again, how many people you want to influence, but focusing on creating value. I think that all of us, even in an organization which has different objective than what we are, the objective that we are here sharing with this idea of infinite game, I think that we can influence. And we have to have the mindset of we can influence, we have the responsibility to influence, because otherwise, if we don't have this mindset, nothing is going to happen. So I think it's a question of belief, and I think it's the question that if all of us, even again, if we can influence only a few people, we can really make the difference in our organization.
Okay, thank you very much, Simona. And just wanted to check with regards to the rest of the presentation, do you have any last slides you'd like to share with the audience?
Yes, let me. Yeah, that's a little bit, in reality, that's the last slide that I wanted to present to you. It's aligned with what Barbara was asking, no? Business has the responsibility to increase the sum of human well-being. So it probably is a little bit idealistic, but I think that if you put together all the pieces of the discussion that we had, infinite game, coaching, responsibility, marketing, services, having a product that is creating value, I think that we really should have this this ideal of really creating a business which is able to influence internally and externally, and influence and increase the human of well-being. Then, of course, that's Jonathan, what I'm always sharing now with the with people asking me why for me is so important. For us, it's easier in a sense, because we are in a business which is influencing, if you want, the well-being of the people. And for me, again, is having worked in different kind of business, is fantastic to be part of the business where the mission of the business is really, as I repeat it again, helping people living a longer, healthier and better life. But again, I think that each of us can do and can influence in this way in the organization where we work.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much, Simona. If there are other questions from the audience, please feel free to put them into the chat. I have a question, Simona, just to try and bring some of these elements together. Also, with regards to what you're doing there at Clinique La Prairie, you've talked about that health is the new wealth. You've talked about the importance of building immunity, especially during this time. But you've been doing it for 90 years. I mean, it's not something you've actually changed doing. You're just reinforcing what you've already been doing for a long period of time. I'm just wondering how we can maybe bring this into leadership and the importance of the health side, performance side, and immunity boosting side when you're in leadership positions. There's been quite a few articles recently about, you know, advising leaders to take responsibility and to take care of themselves, that they should be very careful about things like stress. They should be very careful about things like prioritization with regards to, you know, your well-being, friends, family, and their work, because if they're not in a good place, they can't lead the business. So I just wonder if we can maybe kind of broad, you know, connect a few of these things together. And it would be good to know your thinking about bringing these elements together as a leader and what your view is on that in terms of holistic leadership.
Right. Listen, wonderful question. Let's say first, there is a parallel, like you said, which I think is very interesting, which we have seen in terms of global health, because people like companies who has been affected most by this crisis has been the people and the company which were not healthy when the COVID arrived. No. So this idea of, I love this parallel of, no, the idea of the company as to, if you think infinite game, it means that you always has the objective to keep the company healthy in a sense, even ready for the worst. And that's the same that we have to do on our side. La Prairie, Clinique La Prairie, we have always worked, the focus has been the immune system, no? And the immune system in a sense is the first barrier that we have. Then you have all the other system, respiratory system, the cardiovascular system that of course has to be healthy, but the immune system is of course the base. And that's why we work a lot. The revitalization program that we have is basically working in strengthening the immune system. And we as a leader, I can share with you personally a discovery that I made since I'm here, which is meditation, which for me has been extremely useful. And as you know, there are hundreds of studies which are linking the immune system and meditation. And I found it a wonderful practice, of course, beside the most traditional practice, which is eating healthy and keep moving, which are the practices that we share with our four pillars. Medical one is the first pillar of Clinique La Prairie. Nutrition is the second pillar. Well-being, which is also including spiritual well-being, meditation, what we do in the spire, is the third pillar, and the fourth pillar is the movement. So all the four pillars are important. Is what you were calling holistic. That's what for us is an holistic approach. And out of these four pillars, I have found personally, and this is another invitation for all the listener, to really deep dive on the magic that meditation can do. Now we have a lot of also people in the business that are professing the benefit of meditation. Ray Dalio, which is, you probably know him, is the biggest investor in the world, is a big meditator and is also founding a lot of school and development of the meditation. This is, I think, is really a game changer. So if I should suggest to the people listening, one thing to do, takes time. We are talking about 20 minutes twice a day, but it's really a game changer. You are also doing it, right, Jonathan? So you know what I'm talking about.
I started relatively recently, about a year ago, and it's had a dramatic impact, positive impact on my life. Yeah, and actually, that just as a side note, I actually got into it because I had read a lot of leadership biographies, and there was a constant theme around this that I would say almost up to, you know, 30-40% of the leaders that I'd read about on various discussions had a form of meditation. So they addressed all of these different four pillars. So hence it was, I thought, well, if it works for some of the best performers in the world, I might as well give it a try. So I think it is time. I wanted to say, first of all, Simona, thank you very much for all of the preparations that you've put into doing this. I know this is the first time you've done a more very much personalized to your thinking session. I mean, it's a departure from just presenting about the Clinique, but you've put it in a way that it has shown your personal leadership style and how you've got through this crisis. And also you've been very open and transparent with the audience and with myself in terms of sharing some personal insights, which I think and I hope and I know that the audience will appreciate. So I just wanted to say a big thank you, and I wish you much success with the opening of La Clinique next week. So good times are starting again. So, and thank you very much, Simona. Thank you.
Thank you for inviting me. Thank you very much, Jonathan.